Now it is different to us. We are all clinicians. We are all clinicians here. We are making regular COVID rounds. We are doing administrative work of the department. This agenda is prepared in last 14 hours with the mammoth inputs from the faculty members. I know that after many days, you are attending such session, and after many days, we are also taking a session. So we have got this podium. So we are using maximum part of this, you know, because the teacher in us is coming out. But the student in you also should come out. Please attend it carefully, because today is our 90th day of COVID. On 1st August, I will be celebrating so-called my 100 days of COVID, isn't it? COVID duty. But after 3 months from now, you will have your first century, I will have another century. Because COVID is not going to go from Mumbai like this. The days are yet to start. The normal life is yet to resume. Entire world is a second spike. So please, if you are feeling that, apne duty nahi hai, aapko to kya sab sunne ka hai, please, mera to orthopedic hai. You know that one of the best people who are working in COVID is orthopedic surgeons, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah. Working very well.
Surgeon, orthopedic surgeon, ENT, ortho. So we are recommending university that MS ko MD degree dena sabko. And MD wala ko double degree dena. Yeah, that is what is going to happen. So please don't have a feeling that apna time aayega. Tumhara bhi time aayega COVID ka. Always remember. So be attentive. And now there are two practical sessions. So please attend them care, attend to them very carefully. I understand that you stayed for a long, for adult learning. You know, my medical education colleague is sitting there, and what is happening here, that we are going on and on, but we have to do it, because this is very important, this is need of our. You have come from so many different institutions, a long gap, and this you must have heard, read, but that is all knowledge which is not important. This is the knowledge which is practical, because the entire faculty members are working in and out, with the experiences that are coming out. So please be attentive. Right? Yeah. Now, break the last. Nirakshi, sir, please.
Thank everybody is charged after sir giving a short break. I am Dr. Neelakshi Sablis. I am working as an assistant professor in Department of Medicine. So if you ask any of the faculty members from whichever department then they have worked in wards, if you ask them to name one thing which definitely works in COVID, I think all of them will have to say oxygen. So that's why whether you have come from an orthopedic department or a radiology JR or a surgery JR, you would have not thought in your when you are joining your PG that you will have to learn about oxygen and ventilators. But now that you will be put in wards independently, where you may not have a colleague from medicine or anesthesia or any critical care person with you, you will be the person in charge. So there is certain basics of oxygenation and ventilation that you will be expected to know, because you cannot leave a desaturating patient in front of you, right? So you need to know little basics about oxygen. So we'll be trying to just touch upon all these aspects in today's lecture. So, throughout the course of this short talk, we are going to learn about what exactly do you define and mean by hypoxia, how will you assess for hypoxia in your patient, what is this PF ratio, which is being mentioned in many guidelines as a part of how to approach the patient. So we learn about how to calculate PF ratio easily from whatever information is available. Learn about the different oxygen delivery devices, which patient to be put on which type of oxygen device. How do you classify them, like a fixed performance versus a variable performance. I'll come to that subsequently. And finally, in short, about one or two clinical cases which you will routinely encounter in your wards and ICUs. So now, when we come to oxygen, all the drugs and all are prescribed by a registered medical practitioner, but we never think of oxygen as a drug. Anything in excess is going to cause its own repercussions, it will have its own results, right? The same goes about oxygen. A patient who is not requiring too much of oxygen, if you put them on 100% oxygen for a prolonged period of time, that itself can have its own adverse effects. So that's why oxygen is considered as a drug ever since it has been started using in medical practice. The aim of oxygen therapy is to treat hypoxia without increasing carbon dioxide levels. This especially becomes important in your COPD patients who are prone to develop CO2 retention in the lungs, right? Therefore, oxygen is to be considered as a drug prescribed appropriately and judiciously. Use the correct oxygen device for the correct patient. So these are certain important terms. I'm not sure if you might be aware, so I just put them down here. What is SpO2? Is the saturation of oxygen, which is estimated by a pulse oximeter, right? Now, what does this SpO2 actually indicate? Hemoglobin is the one which is going to bind to your oxygen molecules. So if somebody has a saturation of 98%, it means out of 100 molecules of hemoglobin, 98 have been occupied or have bound to oxygen. That is what this SpO2 means. SaO2 is the actual arterial saturation of blood, for which you require an arterial blood gas analysis to be done. It is an invasive procedure and it has its own we are facing issues in getting ABGs done for all of our patients. That's why pulse ox is the one which is going to be routinely used in our COVID wards, right? Then the next term is PaO2, or the partial pressure of oxygen in blood. Okay, that usually is measured in millimeters of mercury. That also information you will get only from an ABG. Pulse ox will not give you that. So a normal level of PaO2 is 80 to 100. Sorry, it's a typo error. It's 100 mmHg. FiO2 means the fraction of inspired air which is constituted by oxygen. Normally in atmospheric air, how much is the percentage of oxygen? 21%. Rest of that is other gases like nitrogen, carbon dioxide, right? So only 21% of the inspired air is oxygen. When our patient starts desaturating, is breathless, we give oxygen in higher than 21% concentration. So that is when you label it as 40%, 30%, 60%, that is what is the FiO2. And last is the PF ratio, which is the ratio of PaO2 to FiO2, means that how much the patient is getting versus how much you are getting on this blood analysis, right? So that is the PF ratio. Now, how do you define hypoxia? Hypoxia is mainly when the amount of oxygen which the cells are receiving is inadequate to meet the metabolic demands of the cell. That is what is labeled as hypoxia. There are different types. I won't go into too much details. It is hypoxic hypoxia when actually the saturation is low. Anemic hypoxia when the oxygen carrying capacity is low, which can happen with anemic patients. This you would have learned in your MCQ books also, I said. So stagnant hypoxia in a shock, a heart failure patients where the blood supply is hampered, ischemia. Histotoxic hypoxia mainly seen with cyanide poisoning. So to label a patient as being hypoxic, if on pulse oximetry you are finding a saturation of less than 90%, or on an APG analysis you find a PaO2 of less than 60, that is when you label a patient as being purely hypoxic. Okay? 900 ka saturation, 98 IR, that doesn't mean that patient is actually hypoxic. Okay? So you can also, it's not really a very perfect nomenclature, but you can sort of grade hypoxia to know how much O2 you need to give to a patient depending upon their PaO2 levels, right? So normal, like I told you, is about 70 or 80 to 100. Mild hypoxia is between 60 to 80. Moderate is 40 to 60, and less than 40 mmHg of PaO2 means patient is severely hypoxic. So your prognosis and the kind of oxygen delivery device will depend upon this. How will the patient? By asking the patient for history of breathlessness, of course. And what signs will you look for? A respiratory rate. Okay. Silently patient is breathing is not complaining of hypoxia, but if you count, not complaining of breathlessness. If you count the respiratory rate, a rate of more than 25 or some guidelines mention 30, definitely you classify the patient as SARI, as what Dr. Kaustubh also has told you, right? Like severe acute respiratory illness, where your respiratory rate goes more than 25 or 30. So high respiratory rate, use of accessory muscles of respiration like the sternocleidomastoid or scalenite. Patient is definitely turning blue in front of you. So there is cyanosis or bluish discoloration of your membranes and your skin, nails. And finally, the later stages, especially in elderly patients in COVID, we are finding this, that the patients are getting altered. Their sensorium is getting affected, they are getting obtunded. These are the patients who will be severely hypoxic and they may not be even able to communicate. These are all clinical signs of hypoxia. Then how will you check for hypoxia? I've already told you that there are two methods. One is an invasive, one is non-invasive. The non-invasive and what we routinely and a very handy method is the handheld small pulse oximeter. Now this pulse oximeter is in too much demand in COVID right now. So you will see even, I mean, normal people in the community have bought and kept it at home. That is how important it is. So of course, in a hospital setup, we cannot do without pulse oximeters, right? So that is a handheld one, or the ICUs may have them attached to the monitors. So that is going to give you two readings. One is the SpO2 and the other is going to be the heart rate of the patient. So two very critical readings the pulse ox is going to give you. We have already learned about resting tachycardia as an indicator of severe form of disease. The other one of course is the SpO2, right? Arterial blood gas analysis is the ideal way of actually assessing the oxygenation of the patient. But in COVID, we are facing a lot of difficulties where there are no relatives, servants are in PPE inside. Who will take these ABG syringes to our labs? So many a times we have to rely upon the pulse ox readings. So make sure that you take them properly and document them wherever. Like the first point of entry in triage, the person has to document a cough O2 or a room air saturation of the patient. If it is 60 or 70%, he has to alert the next person that this patient is really hypoxic and needs to be attended to immediately, right? Versus a patient who is 98% saturation, although complaining of breathlessness, but is doing better. Okay? So ABG will give you all sorts of values like pH, PICARS, SaO2, and as well as the PaO2 levels. Pulse oximeter, I won't go into too much details. We've already learnt about this. It is less invasive, of course. This is how your ABG report is going to look like. It will give you all these values about pH, PCO2, PaO2, your PICARB and all. The normal values also I have listed alongside. So normal pH is between 7.35 to 7.45. PCO2 of the arterial blood is between 35 to 45. Hypercapnia is when it goes above that level. PaO2 normal is 70 to 100. Less than that is hypoxia. Saturation is mentioned as 93 to 98% and PICARB. Now, like I said, that we don't do ABG for all patients. So how do you know that, you know, what is the approximate PaO2? Because how will you calculate pH ratio otherwise? Now, actually, for all practical purposes, we are relying upon the pulse oximeter SpO2. So there is a way where you can estimate. It may not be the exact number, but you can form an estimate about the PaO2 depending upon the saturation probe levels that you get. So this is a small chart which I have shown here, that if a SpO2 of a patient is 397, then the approximate PaO2 is going to be about more than 100, right? Same thing when it goes down about 86, SpO2 as low as 51, right? Normal definition of hypoxia, we said it is less than 60. So anybody who is less than 90, if you see, the saturation of the PaO2 is going less than 60 mmHg. So this chart, you can keep it handy in your mobile phones or your tab. I would not advise you to use your mobile much, but there are tabs in each word which we can keep these, and there we can print these charts and also put it in the word so that you are aware that how hypoxic your patient really is without using a ABG. Okay, so this is how you can estimate the PaO2. Now coming to calculation of PF ratio, like I said, it is the ratio of the PaO2 upon the FiO2, means the how much inspired oxygen you are giving to the patient, which is expressed in a decimal. Like 40% oxygen if a patient is inhaling, it is expressed as 0.4, right? A ratio, normally in a normal person it is less than 4, I mean more than 400 or 500. In AR, to define a adult respiratory distress syndrome or ARDS, the PF ratio when it is less than 300, we label that the patient is having respiratory failure or ARDS, right? So that is how I have written here. Less than 300 is mild ARDS, between 200 to 300 is mild, less than 100 to 200 is moderate, and less than 100 is severe ARDS, right? Now, if what information does this PF ratio give us? So basically, if a PF ratio is less than 300, it means that if you leave the patient to breathe on a normal room air, this PO2 would be less than 60. If the PF ratio is less than 250, it means that PO2 is 50, right? So on and so forth. If you leave the patient on room air. Now let's see one example how we calculate the PF ratio actually. So a gentleman complains of dyspnea, he underwent ABG analysis, and these are his readings. Saturation is 96%, SaO2 is 96%, PaO2 is 8. So how will you calculate the PF ratio? What is the FiO2 here? He's breathing room air, so it is 20, right? So the ratio is 380. How did we arrive at that? So his PaO2 is 80 divided by FiO2, which is 0.21. So that's how we got the ratio as 380, which is normal. Okay? So this is how you calculate. Now another patient, XYZ, complaining of breathlessness, SpO2 by pulse oximeter was 88%. Okay, definitely it's less than 90, so patient is hypoxic. He was started on face mask with 40% oxygen, and after some time his ABG was set. Now this is the ABG report which you got after the patient started breathing on 40% FRO. So saturation is 98, PO2 is 90. PO2 has come up. Are you happy with that part? So that is why you need the PF ratio, because at 40% FiO2, this PaO2 has come to little 90. So that's why the PF ratio is still less than 300. That is the importance of PF ratio, because if you just go by a saturation or PaO2 values, absolute values as such, you may not pick up serious kind of patients. Okay? That is what I've shown. So which means that if you leave this patient to breathe on room air, this PO2 would have been as low as 45. Okay. Now, calculating PF ratio from the pulse oximeter. Now, many a times, like we said, we don't get PaO2 values on ABG. So depending upon saturation values, you can judge your PaO2 values and calculate these PF ratio. That is what is being shown here. Okay. Now, why is it important to search for this, to calculate this PF ratio in COVID? If you see, most guidelines are defining the categories as mild, moderate, severe and looking out for red flag signs depending upon this PF ratio. Many of your higher therapies like tocilizumab, itolizumab or convalescent plasma give you a limit of PO2 FiO2 ratio. You are below which or above which you are supposed to use this drug. For example, for itolizumab, there was a criteria of between 200 to 300. Same goes for convalescent plasma, right? So this is why it is important to calculate this ratio in your COVID patients. Now we come to actually, how do we deliver this oxygen therapy to our patients? If you see our wards, we have a main central oxygen supply unit in the hospital, which is in the form of liquid oxygen. Then it gets compressed and finally gas. In the form of gas, oxygen is released. It comes through various yellow colored pipes you would have seen in the wards. In all hospitals, that is the same status. The yellow pipe denotes oxygen pipe, right? So it reaches the wards through these yellow pipes, and finally at different points you will see oxygen sockets being given, or ports as we call them, right? So the oxygen is coming at 100%. Depending upon the flow meter readings, you can actually control how much of FiO2 you want to give. So I've just got a flow meter with me. This is the flow meter. If you see, the lower portion, it is a wall mounted flow meter, right? So this portion is going to go inside in that open port. This is the flow meter where the readings are from 1 to 15, and there is a knob with which you can increase or decrease the FiO2 that you want to give. The maximum flow which you can give is 15 liters, the minimum is 1 liter, okay? With the normal flow meter. Of course, the higher flow, HFNC and all, they have a different flow meter of their own. This is the humidifier. Why do you need a humidifier? Because when you give oxygen for a prolonged period to a patient, which is dry, patient will not be able to tolerate it. The mucous membranes become dry, there will be a tendency to remove the oxygen again and again. Right? So if you give a humidified oxygen, it is much better tolerated. It matches the temperature also of the body. Right? That is what is being shown here. So this I have already conveyed to you, like how the oxygen actually travels up to our wards and how do we control it. Now coming to the oxygen devices. So oxygen devices are further divided depending upon the exact FiO2 which they deliver to a patient as fixed versus a variable FiO2. What does this distinction mean? Fixed FiO2 means if I set the level at say 30%, it will give 30% and nothing more and nothing less. But there are certain oxygen devices which we commonly use, like the nasal cannula, like your normal face mask, which also depends upon the flow of air from atmosphere which the patient takes in. Let me give you an example. It's a little difficult to understand, so let me just give you an example. You have started a patient on a face mask who is very acutely breathless at a flow of 5 liters per minute or 6 liters per minute, say. Okay? Means in a minute, it's going to deliver oxygen at the rate of 6 liters. But patient is so breathless, his respiratory rate is more than 30, he is going to suck in air from the other ports in the mask from atmosphere. And how much is the percentage of oxygen in that? 21%. So finally, when it is going to reach his lower airways, it's going to be diluted. So probably what he is getting is maybe just 26, 28 or 30 maximum, and not 40 or 60 what we are actually you have put the patient on. This will also matter when you are calculating your FiO2 PO2 FiO2 ratio, because you are not actually giving 100% oxygen and you are putting that value FiO2 as 100. So that's why applying the mask, applying the candidate correctly and to the correct patient is important. If your patient's respiratory rate is high, his peak inflow of air, inspired air is very high, your lower devices may not work. The FiO2 will reduce because of dilution. Okay? So that is what it means. Against which you compare a venturi mask, it is going to actually deliver what it is supposed to deliver. If you pick the flow rate correctly. Okay? So now let's start with the first one. So this is what I have already explained to you. So FiO2 which goes to the patient depends upon what you said, the device which you have used, and mainly depends upon your patient. How stable he is or how bad he is and what device you have put on. Okay? So now first coming to the normal nasal cannula. Okay, so this what you are seeing in the picture is a plastic or a PVC cannula to which you have these prongs attached. Right, you can see them in the picture as well. Now these prongs are attached to the nostril of the patient, and this end, the other end, is connected to the flow meter. Right, the flow meter will be going inside the oxygen supply. From here you will start the oxygen. This end will go into the patient's nostril. This is the first and basic oxygen device which you can use. Okay, there are merits and demerits of each. I will come to that subsequently. So hope you have understood how to attach this, right? Now, so this is preferred when the patient is breathing on his own. First of all, he is conscious, cooperative, and the FiO2 requirement is not very high. Means that the patient is not very severely hypoxic. The advantage of this is that the mouth of the patient is free. If you put a mask on a patient, his mouth also gets covered. He is not able to talk, he is not able to eat, he is not able to drink. So every time he has to do all these activities, he has to remove the mask and then do it. Which you leave the patient hypoxic for some time. And we have had patients who are maintaining on mask, the moment they remove this to eat or drink, desaturating to as low levels as 76% and 80%. The advantage of this nasal cannula is that, you need not remove it, that is comfortable for the patient. How much FiO2 can you give with this? It depends upon the oxygen inflow. Normally, to begin with, you start the nasal cannula with a flow of 2 to 3 liters per minute. More than that, even if it is mentioned on the inset that you can give up to 6 liters, patient will not tolerate. Because too much of high flow which is not humidified correctly will dry up the mucous membrane. After a period of time, patient will start getting headache and all, he won't be able to tolerate. So start with about 2 to 3 liters per minute. As you increase the flow, every 1 liter from the flow meter is going to increase the FiO2 by 4%. Means if you have kept it at 1 liter, it will deliver 24%. 2 liters, it will become 28%. 3 liters, 32%. So on and so forth, right? So this is what is shown here. Flow rate and the FiO2 which it delivers. So every ml increase, it is going to increase your FiO2 by 4%. So the maximum that you can go, like I said, is 3 to 4 liters is what the patient is going to tolerate. So the moment the FiO2 requirement goes more than 35-40%, patient is unfit to receive nasal cannula. Okay? You have to move to a higher device. Okay? So this can be initiated in stable patients who are just mildly hypoxic, say 92-93% saturation, comfortable. On those patients you can initiate. Very stable patients, monitor the respiratory rate, monitor the SpO2. If any time you feel that there is deterioration in any form, switch to a higher device. Okay? Next is the simple face mask. You would have seen this in your internship postings and all that, right? Now this portion is where your oxygen cord, which we just saw, is going to connect. And these are the exhalation ports through which the expired air is going to be pushed out. And the inflow of oxygen will be from here. It is important that the mask fits properly and the patient keeps it on his nose and mouth both and not down here like this. You will see many patients who are on prolonged oxygen therapy, they will keep their mask down. It's not going to help. The oxygen, it has to cover your nose mainly. Okay? It's important that when you are starting the patient on face mask, keep the flow rate on the flow meter of at least 5 liters. If you keep the flow rate less than that, there will be build up of CO2 inside the mask, which the patient will keep re-breathing, and your saturation levels will start dropping because FiO2 won't be achieved. So at least a 5 liter flow you have to begin. Flow can grow up to 10 liters on a face mask. On nasal cannula it was maximum 4 to 6 liters. Here it is 10 liters. Okay? That is what we have discussed here. And the FIO2 that it can give is 35% to 60%. There are two things when you are giving oxygen. One is the flow and one is the FIO2. Right? Both things matter. Okay. Next one. So this is the estimate of FIO2 depending upon what flow rate you have set for a normal oxygen mask. If you have set the flow rate at 5 to 6 liters per minute, you are achieving a FIO2 of 40%. 6 to 7, it will be 50%. And 7 to 8, it will be 60. So 60% FIO2 is the maximum which you can give on the normal face mask. Okay? The advantage is that it is non-invasive. The normal NIV ventilator marks and all, they leave all marks. Your patient is quite uncomfortable. Your the patient is okay, he is comfortable. Disadvantage is he will have to remove it when he wants to eat and drink. Okay. Next we come to the little higher device, but a variable FiO2 is the non-breathing mask. This mask is very important because most of your severe patients in your wards are going to be on this mask rather than the lower ones which we just discussed, right? When you are weaning, that is when your face mask and your nasal prongs and all become important. A severely hypoxic patient, first you will put on a, but a conscious patient, you will first put on a non-rebreathing one. Why is it called as a non-rebreathing? It has a reservoir bag here, okay? The moment you attach this to a flow meter and the oxygen flow starts, there is a valve here which will prevent the expired air or the atmospheric air to go into this. It will only allow a unidirectional oxygen flow. So it acts as a reservoir, concentrates the oxygen, and this device can deliver about 95 to 100% of oxygen. That is, the FIO2 can go as high as 95 to 100%. Okay? But the important thing about this mask is that it has to be fit correctly. If the fit is not correct, he will again start drawing air from atmosphere and there will be dilution. So it is important that the mask fits correctly to the patient. Okay? So the flow rate which you will set when you are applying, this is very important. When you are applying a non-rebreathing mask to a patient, please set the flow rate to maximum, that is 15. Below that, the bag will not get inflated. Patient will have rebreathing CO2 retention. Set the flow rate to 15 only, then the bag is going to get inflated and your reservoir will actually do its action. Okay? It's a temporary measure. You will evaluate the patient. If he is deteriorating, you might have to switch to higher, more reliable means of oxygenation. Right? So, the merits are that it gives you a higher FiO2, almost 100% FiO2 if applied correctly. Demerits is that, like we said, if not used correctly, it could lead to air dilution, rebreathing and CO2 retention. So, many COPD patients, if you are putting on this mask, they go into CO2 retention and narcosis. Okay? And it's uncomfortable, of course, because of the tight fit. Then the next level of mask are the Venturi masks. Okay? It's called as a Venturi mask. It works on the principle of Bernoulli effect. That when oxygen or any gas is passed through a constriction, its velocity increases, the flow increases, but the pressure drops. So these are much better tolerated masks. And the advantage of these masks is that there is less of air dilution.
If you see, I'll show you the
picture also, you can see there are various color coded these adapters, okay, which come with the mask. So on this adapter it is written 40%, 10 liters. It is going to tell you both how much FiO2 you are going to achieve and how much minimum flow you need to keep to achieve that. Okay? That will vary as per the different codings. I'll just come to that. Okay? So it's a fixed performance, means it is delivering exactly that much FiO2 as far as possible. Now the mechanism is what is shown here. If you see this, it's shown in the picture as well. There are pores here through which it is going to entrain or it is going to allow atmospheric air to come in. And through the narrow aperture, it is going to take in the 100% oxygen that you are giving. Okay, there will be mixing here, and because patient is drawing air from outside, his flow requirement of flow is maintained because of this. The advantage of this over the lower thing is the amount of flow that you can give. FiO2 can be as less as 24%, 30%, 46%, whereas an NRBM is achieving almost 100%. But this will give what it is supposed to give because of this principle of Bernoulli effect. Okay, it's very useful in COPD patients. Prevent CO2 retention. When you are weaning, what we have practically observed in our wards is that when you are weaning a patient from oxygen, this becomes reliable because you know that how much FiO2 patient's requirement is and how it is coming down. Okay, so this is what it is showing. Blue gives you a FiO2, this blue color adapter is going to give you a FiO2 of 24%. The minimum flow that you need to set is 2 liters and so on and so forth. So this is important to remember when you are practically using the minimums. Next, coming to a little higher flow of oxygen, that is the high flow nasal cannula. Now there have been various studies in COVID patients who have been put on these as compared to ventilators, and they have done better. So this machine has suddenly gained a lot of importance in the COVID era, and we didn't have too many HFNCs in our hospital. It was mainly used only in anesthesia circuits and all that. But now in our COVID wards, we are having these machines. Why? Because we want to prevent the patient from going onto a ventilator as far as possible, and this will help you in doing that, right? This is what is being shown here, that it consists of a cannula which goes like a normal nasal cannula into the nostrils of the patient, and there is a circuit which connects that to the humidifier. The advantage of this over a normal nasal cannula is that you are giving a properly humidified 37 degrees Celsius oxygen to the patient at much higher flow rates, which will compensate for the increased work of breathing that the patient is having. So this is going to achieve your FiO2 as well as your flow. That's why the name high flow humidified nasal oxygen. Okay. So the like we discussed, the normal flow meter, you can achieve only 15 to 16 liters. This can achieve up to 60 liters of flow. Okay. FiO2 can go from 21 to 100%. Okay. It is in a humidified fashion that you are giving. In which patients you will avoid CO2 retention or hypercapnia because too much of oxygen you are giving. But in control settings with a lower FiO2, you can still use them in those patients as well. Don't use it altered or hemodynamically unstable patients or multi-organ dysfunction patients. The advantage of this HFNC and how it prevents the patient from going on a ventilator is that it gives a small amount of peak. Do you all know what is peak? Right? Positive end expiratory pressure. When we expire, our expiratory pressures drop, right? It becomes in the negative. But we give a continuous positive pressure in these ERDS patients to keep the alveoli painted so that oxygenation does not suffer. So this machine gives you a peak of say 5 to 6. That's why the sort of like a mini ventilator kind of a function. Okay? So I won't go into too much of details. These are there in the wards. You will use them under the guidance of the faculty, because you need to get used to how to, you know, connect the entire circuit and all. Okay. Now, as per most recommendations, it's given in the guidelines to use HFNCs and non-invasive ventilators as compared to invasive ventilation in all COVID patients. Coming to NIV, two modes are there on the ventilator which are non-invasive. One is the CPAP or pressure support, and second is the BiPAP. I won't go into too much of details of the ventilatory settings and all that. So when a patient on NRVN or HFNC is still not maintaining saturation, that is when you will think of putting the patient on a ventilator, right? First you will start with a non-invasive if the patient is conscious for breathing. Now for this you need this, first is the ventilator of course, you need the circuit, and you need these NIV masks. You see on the right hand side, it's a very tight fitting mask which you secure with the help of those straps. That is why the disadvantage of this is that the patient is very uncomfortable, okay? But of course, if it has to be put, it has to be put. So you need to probably put a rice tube before you put on this mask so that you can feed the patient to the RT, because you cannot remove this mask again and again, otherwise there is loss of the positive airway pressure that you are generating. Okay? Finally, the last form of oxygenation or ventilation is invasive ventilation. When all other lower modalities have failed and still the patient is hypoxic, not maintaining saturation, or it becomes hemodynamically unstable, those are the patients which will require this invasive ventilation. Of course, you can, understand the mortality in COVID patients who are being intubated and put on ventilators is very high. So we want to prolong or delay intubation as far as possible. Earlier, there was a strategy proposed where they had told us that we use early intubation. Like a patient who is on NRVN, not maintaining, immediately could intubate the patient and put him on a ventilator. But with subsequent studies, they realized that these patients are not coming out. We are losing them compared to those who have been tried on HFNC or NIV. That's why there has been a change in the recommendation, and invasive ventilation we are avoiding as far as possible. In the COVID settings, when we are intubating the patient, it requires placement of an endotracheal tube, which is a very highly aerosol generating procedure. So it is recommended that you wear full PPE including a face shield. Some of our most of medicine colleagues will be, or anesthesia colleagues might be, will have to do this kind of procedures. It may not be expected from the JRs from other departments, right? So while doing this, you have to take utmost care that you are wearing full PPE with the face shield. Also, there are these, if you see in the lower picture, a transparent intubation hood through which your both hands go inside. There is a video laryngoscope through which you can visualize the vocal cords, and under vision you can place a endotracheal tube. Right? This is called as a rapid sequence intubation with pre-medication with certain anesthetic drugs like propofol and your skeletal muscle relaxing agents. Right? This has to be done by a skilled personnel. The use of this intubation hood is to prevent too much of aerosol generation and infection of the healthcare worker. So generally we put the patient on a volume AC mode and start with a peak of at least more than 5. The aim of invasive ventilation should be to get a PaO2 of at least 55 to 80 with a SpO2 of 88 to 90. If we can achieve even that much, it's great. Now finally, like we said, we are going to higher levels of oxygen. But is it like we have to keep the patient on 100% oxygen for the entire period? No. Why do we try to wean them? Because oxygen, like I said earlier, has its own adverse effect, and some of them are mentioned here, that you will suppress the respiratory drive of the patient if you give too much of oxygen. More than 50% for oxygen, FiO2 for more than 48 hours can have its own hazards. Okay? So that's why we need to assess what is our target of oxygenation. If the patient is not at a risk of type 2 respiratory failure like our COPD or OAD patients, you will achieve a saturation of not more than, around 94 to 98% is acceptable. In COPD patients, you will try to achieve a saturation of 88 to 92%. Okay? Just in a nutshell, we'll go through important points related to oxygenation and ventilation, especially in COVID patients. So assess all your patients with pulse oximetry as frequently as it is advisable to detect hypoxia. Watch for signs of respiratory distress. Watch for the respiratory rate and accessory muscle use. If saturation is less than 94 and the rate is more than 40, then label the patient as SADI. See to it that the patient gets intensive care management. In COVID especially, be aware of happy hypoxia like it is being labeled, because patients sometimes are so asymptomatic, and if you take the saturation, it is 87-88%. And when you tell them that you are sick, you need to be put on oxygen, they don't agree, because they are absolutely or relatively asymptomatic, right? That's why it's called as happy hypoxia. So be aware of this, of the paradoxically well appearing patient. Start supplemental O2 and apply contact precautions when you are handling the devices which have been used by a patient, as they are potentially infectious. CARP protocol, try to follow and advise your patients as much as possible. Dr. Kaustubh has already told you that it is COVID awake repositioning technique, right, protocol, where you apply different positions, especially proning. Proning is said to increase your PO2. How? Because more diseased lungs are the ones which are more perfused. So when you put the patient on prone, that shunt, the level of shunt drops and the oxygenation improves. So that is the principle behind that. Start your bad hypoxic patients on at least 5 liters per minute through face mask to achieve a SpO2 of more than 90% in non-pregnant, and in pregnant females 92 to 96%. This is as per the Maharashtra guidelines. Coming to which patient will need which O2 device, mildly hypoxic, put them on a face mask or nasal cannula. Moderate or severely hypoxic means the SpO2 is less than 85%. Put the patient straight onto a non-rebreathing mask at 15 liters per minute. Like I said, not less than 15 liters. If in spite of that fails to maintain, then and the fulfill the definition of ARDS as per SPF ratio, consider HFNC or NIV. Hemodynamically unstable patients invariably will have to be intubated. So this is what we have discussed. This is going to show you the various cannulae and how much FiO2 they give. Now last, coming to one case, a 64-year-old gentleman is a diabetic, hypertensive on treatment, presents with mild fever, cough, breathlessness. Neighbor has been recently detected as COVID positive. How will you evaluate him? Of course, you will do a pulse oximeter. He is complaining of breathlessness. So on the pulse oximeter, the saturation is 88%, his respiratory rate is 26. How much is the PF ratio? So SpO2 you have got, you have not done an APG, so 88. On that chart, you will see that the PaO2 value, which is corresponding to 88, is 54. So his PaO2 FiO2 ratio comes to 257. How will you manage? Which of these will you choose? Which one? So at least a face mask, or rather it would be better to put him on a non-lingering, right? So he started on a face mask, but it is just at 3 liters and he still goes in. Because you gave a lower floor. Like I said, you have to start face mask with at least 5 liters. So probably he would have got CO2 retention because of rebreathing. That's why he has not improved. Put him on NRP. Now this is a more severe patient, 38 year old, no comorbidities, diagnosed recently positive, comes with recesses and cough, it's worsening. SpO2 on admission, HO2 is 76%. He's tachycardic, heart there, tachycardia, patient is in distress. So how will you initiate HO2 delivery? We'll try to put him straight away on NRPM. We'll not do the antics of the nasal prongs and all because the patient is not fit for that. Okay? After 1 to 2 hours, you re-evaluate the patient. If he's still breathless, try to put the patient on high flow nasal cannula or higher motega NRPM. Okay? Thank you.